can hear his talk on INO.
I can start, right? Well, and so congratulations to IMSC on its 60th birthday. And it's unfortunate that I am not there in person, but I hope and you are having your cakes and all those things. And during my next visit, I'll be also getting some share of my cake. And I'm also missing the talks that the neutrino experts there are giving, Boris and Andre and Sandro, and I'll be really missing their talks also. Now that, let me, I'll concentrate mostly, I think, since the other experts are giving about the, you know, all the details about the neutrino physics. Here, let me just concentrate on the project that we are getting involved with, that is the India-based neutrino observatory project that we want to do it in India. And so this is actually, at the moment, it's a Indian collaboration right now, and already some like 24 people from all around the country are part of this project, and I will hope to see kind of the participation from outside India soon, and now that the project is approved by the government of India. So before I go into the details of INO, I'd like to give you some early history of neutrino physics in India. This is especially for this for the young students that are present in the audience there. And to begin with, actually the underground physics is not new in India. In fact, India had a long tradition of carrying out experiment deep underground. Precisely, it is in 1951 that the underground laboratory was set up at Kolar Gold Field by Tata Institute of Fundamental Research for basically in those days to understand the penetrating component of cosmic rays, which is nowadays called muons. And if you see on this picture, during this long, you know, running of that underground lab at Kolar Gold Field, there has been measured of cosmic ray muon intensity from very shallow depth to a depth of almost 10,000, you know, hectogram equivalent. So that is the type of measurement. So that is, 10,000 hectogram means basically 10 kilometers of water. And intensity, and this depth intensity curve has been used in the past even to get the muon energy spectrum on the surface, and from there it has helped to understand the cosmic ray spectrum and so on. And it was during this measurement of the muon intensities around 1960s then they realized that at a depth of something like 7,000 hectogram of water equivalent, or which is something like 2.3 kilometer underground in the Kolar rock, there is almost no muons coming there. So that may be a possible site for doing neutrino experiment, and that's how the first neutrino experiment was started there and got the measured or detected the atmospheric neutrinos way back in 1965. Here you can see on the left hand side one of the five detectors that were used in that experiment at Kolar Gold Field in 1965. And this is actually a very sophisticated experiment, and you can see on the either side of this is scintillators, mostly to detect or to trigger on the horizontal muons. So if you have a depth of 2.3 kilometer, and in the horizontal direction, there is no effect of anything other than the neutrino interaction in the nearby rock, and that's how they detected the atmospheric neutrinos. Well, That was long way back, and then the past. Now let me come back to the current situation, that is the INO project. Now let me first give the same features of the project. We have an underground laboratory with 1 kilometer all round rock cover that can be accessed through a horizontal tunnel, something like 1.9 kilometers. To do any kind of experimental programs. Of course, the frontline information, the parameters and other studies will be complementary to the ongoing experiment in the nature space. and NIT also supports several other experiments in Operation double beta decay, and dark matter such experiments are foreseen in the near future. So now, also of course, we are looking for international participation. Now, on next slide, slide 8. So, the iron project components, it has several components. Went to the laboratory and surface facility near the Pottikulam Race in Teni district of Tamil Nadu. I'll come to this site a little later. Of course, the construction of a massive 50 kilogram magnetized calorimeter to study properties in neutrinos. And the third thing that we have in our list is the construction of the INO center, which will be the national center for high energy physics in India, called NCHAP. And it will be located in the city of Kulam, which is 110 kilometers away from the underground site. However, in other things, most important that is we do not have enough experimental high energy physicists in the country to take up the construction later on. So we have started a program, what you call the iron training program from 2008, where we are taking PhD students with hands-on training on detector development and various hardware. And this is also a component of our project, and detector R&D will be an integral part of the project. Going to slide 9, just quickly, and now I'm going to talk about the physics in the next couple of slides. So go to slide 10. So this is the physics motivation. So we want to measure atmospheric neutrinos that provide a wide range of energy and length, and then artificial neutrino source. Ability to between neutrinos and anti-neutrinos enable us to efficiently determine the neutrino mass ordering using the Rossmann effect. And we have a magnetized dragon calorimeter so that it will be able to measure very accurately and beyond direction and with our identification capability. And the head-on solar reconstruction along with the muon reconstruction will allow us to measure energy direction and to detect using the same detector ultra-high energy using PR technique. Going to slide 11, the physics goal, I know, the first problem, want to accurately determine the atmospheric parameters, that is the theta 2 3 octane, and the ratio of theta 2 3 for magnetic, and the physics that we are putting focus on is determination of the neutrino mass hierarchy, and as you know, the theta 1 3 happen to be large, and that is an extremely good use for the molecular question, because this will allow us to measure, to address this neutrino mass hierarchy issue in a reasonable time. Then, of course, there is a neutrino factory. We'll be able to determine the CP violation in the tonic sector. And then, our non-standard interaction, CPT violation, long forces, etc., can also be addressed during the iron optical detector. Going to slide number 12. And now, I'm talking about this is the iron location. Now let's go to slide 13. The location, we have another city module. The iron point is located something like 115 km of the central city of Madurai in the Teni district, and it is close to the border of Tamil Nadu. And on the top left, you can see the map of India showing the location of the location of the Madurai city. On the other, if you go west, I will come up to the next time from the. And on the right hand side, you have the beautiful Naxi temple at the Gokwans scene in the city. It's a beautiful city. And of course, Madhya also has an international airport, so that helps a lot. Going to the next currency, number 14, the little more details about this site. You can see on the top left hand side the map where I'm from the Mazda. From the Mazda, go NH40, which is straight, goes to Beni. And actually continues to Kerala to Cochin. However, from Delhi, around 30 kilometers, also I reach the Kerala border, which is in the red line there. Is our location. If you see the picture below, we have this this you can see the mountain, part of the mountain, and you can see from if you are coming from the east, the mountain is like hell. So you cross sea level, and suddenly the mountain rises, and that's where you want to make a turn. And the right side picture on the top, the picture of the mountain, the peak of the, the behind, behind is the peak below which we want to put our cabin. So if you want to contact us, our location is given there in longitude and latitude, and it's in the Pottipuram village in Tamil district of Tamil Nadu state. We will be there soon, permanently. Now let's go to slide number 18. So inside that cavern, we want to build the picture of the cavern. We have three major caverns. One is the large one, something like 130 meters wide length and 6 meters wide and 30 meters height. This cavern, less than half of that will be used for 50 kiloton iron oxide detector, and remaining part will remain empty. That gives us an opportunity if we want to extend it to 100 kiloton in detail. And there will be two caverns, the cavern 2 and cavern 3, where we see the oil experiment, that is NWD or dark matter, will come up, and the whole complex will be constructed now. So this is the underground layout. Let me go to next slide, slide 16, where I'm giving you just the geography of the site. The cavern set in the Charkunite rock, which is a very strong rock, and that this 390 meter ridge. Meter peak, but it is something like 290 meter. Get all round coverage. It's more than actually 1 kilometer in all direction. And we have to go to the camera side, that the rock will be much more than in the other side. This is the one low rainfall area, low humidity, that will help us in operating our pieces well. And sometimes you will use your speed, wind speed there in the session. The next transform number 17. So this characteristics are the following. We have flat terrain with good access to major roads, and except the last several kilometers, we have to cross the road, and that will start soon. All major components will be located underground. We have a small surface facilities on the outside, but not in the forest land. The tunnel and cavern will be under the forest land, but the portal is outside the reserve boundary. So there is no occupation of forest land required at all. And surface facilities will not be on the forest land. So for clearance also, clearing is not required at all. Going to slide number 18. Here I am coming back a little bit about the other side, that is the location of the National Center for High Energy Physics in Madurai. This is actually in the Madurai city itself. In the top picture, I am showing the map. You can see the MKU, that is the Madurai Kamraj University, and below that is the road, that is the highway towards our site location. So something like 100 around 2 kilometers south of Madurai Kamraj University is where the NCF will be located. Below is the picture of what it looks like now. However, we hope that soon this will change into a beautiful science campus there. So what will have that? This place will act as the nodal center for all INO activities. We'll have a major detector development laboratory, and INO graduate training school, which is right now at TI for Mumbai, will move to NCF as soon as the site is ready or the buildings are there. Go to slide number 19. Now, updates on the site front. So we have already the environmental and forest clearance obtained. 26 hectares of land provided free by Tamil Nadu state government for setting up surface facilities near the portal location, that is at the Pottipuram village. Additional 13 hectares of land we have acquired at Madurai, I have shown the picture, for the National Center for High Energy Physics. Tamil Nadu government agencies will start laying water pipeline, approach road construction soon. Actually, we have all the money, approval for the money is already there. I mean, it's just the final approval is required, just to transfer the fund to Tamil Nadu government. and the tender will be released, has been released for the fencing work at both sites. So the pre-project activities have already started, I can say. Now, in slide 20, now I am going to talk about the ICAL detector, INO ICAL, the iron calorimeter detector little more. First, the choice. So what I have said already, should have a large target mass, something like 50 kiloton to begin with, may go to 100 kiloton. Good tracking energy resolution, so it's a tracking calorimeter. Good directionality, so that we can find out the direction of the neutrinos. So that will need something like less than a nanosecond time resolution in your active detector. Should have a charge identification capabilities, because you want to separate out neutrinos from antineutrinos. Ease of construction and the modularity, because though making the 50 kiloton, we want to make it in modular ways, so that part of the detector will be operational when you work on the other parts for the construction. And it should be complementary with other existing and proposed detectors. So we propose to use magnetized iron as target mass and RPC as the active detector medium. So the name comes there, the iron tracking calorimeter or ICAL. Go to slide 22. Here is just a schematic picture of these three modules. Each will be 16 meter by 16 meter by 14.5 meter in height. We'll have something like 150 layers of iron plates. This is 5.6 centimeter iron plates, and with a gap of 4 centimeter for these RPCs to be located. So this is a sandwich of iron plates, and then RPCs, iron plates, RPCs, and so on, make the 150 layers of tracking detector. Going to slide 23, gives you the total fact sheet about this detector. What I wanted to emphasize here, though the detector looks simple, what is actually the task ahead of us is the size. We have to make total of 28,800 of RPCs. Each of them is 2 meter by 2 meter in size almost. And this will be the number of electronic channels, something like 3.7 million. So these are the numbers. So we have to really, you know, make, and there will be a magnetic field of 1.4 Tesla and so on. So this is, go to slide 24. Now I'm going to give you some ideas, because here lots of students are there in the audience. So I'm telling to tell you this work of the construction of RPCs. This is the main heart of the detector, that is the active detector element. It's very simple in design. What you have basically in this picture of, you know, if you're on slide 24, the green color are two glass, float glass actually, each of 3 mm thick. And they are separated by spacer on all four sides. This is shown by the blue color here, and with a gap of 2 mm. And on the outer surface of the glass, both sides, you put a graphite coating, okay, to apply the high voltage. Then you apply a very high voltage of something like 10 kilovolt. And then whenever a charged particle is going through that, and it will ionize the gas inside, and it will create a small pulse of current, and which will be picked up by these pickup strips, which is shown in yellow, orange, and top and bottom, but in orthogonal direction. So you get the location of the point where the charged particle has gone through from the X and Y position. This is the simple construction of the RPC. Now let me go to that one. So in building that one, in the last 5-6 years, we have taken up a large detector development project that is now complete. In this picture of 25, slide number 25, I am showing you some of the components. On the left-hand side, on the top, you are seeing that spacers that will be there in all the four sides of these. See, bottom and top two glass plates will be put. But then these glass plates will be separated by these buttons and placed at regular interval inside the whole detector. On the top right, you have these gas nozzles through which the gas will go in and out. Now you put them together, which is shown on the bottom left side. This is the how the RPCs will be built. And then, of course, in the bottom right, I have shown you the graphite coating on the glass plates, and so that you know, we can apply the high voltage. So these are all the development work that we have started with. And with this, we go to slide 26, where now it goes to the how the ICAL detector will be constructed. So in the top left, you have seen that bottom layer of iron plates, and then you can see the coil in the middle coming up. Then on top of the iron plates, in the middle, top middle, I am showing you these 2 meter by 2 meter RPCs placed rest on top of that iron plate, and then put the next layer of iron plates, and again put the RPCs, and go on constructing finally the one complete model, which is shown in the bottom left corner in the orange color, and the coils with that one, and then we put next to each other three of those modules, and the whole things will go underground, which is shown in the right hand side picture. Go to slide number 27. Here is our, is in a nutshell, this is what we have done in the last 5-6 years. So here my colleague Satyanarayana is standing on his hand. In the one hand he has a 10 centimeter by 30 centimeter size RPC. That is the RPC we started something like 6-7 years back when we started working on this development work. On his other hand, he has a little bigger 30 centimeter by 30 meter, centimeter RPCs. Then of course, once we started making bigger, our another technician, Chowan, is holding here a 1 meter by 1 meter RPCs. And behind Satyanarayana, you can see the real large 2 meter by 2 meter RPCs that are really built for this experiment. And that is something like 30,000 of RPCs is what we needed, we need for this experiment. Now go to slide 28. Here I'm showing you this, when we started the work, you know, we started even with this 10 centimeter by 10 centimeter RPCs, put up a stack of 10 layers of RPCs, and started using the cosmic ray muons as beams for us. We are far away from an accelerator beam, but we can use the cosmic ray muons, and started understanding the details about the tracking capabilities and timing capabilities of these RPCs. Go to slide 29. Here you can see the efficiency on the left-hand side of those RPCs. They are almost more than 90%, and on the right-hand side, the time resolution. That in the black, you can see the time resolution of these RPCs as a function of high voltage, and in the purple, you can see the time resolution of a scintillator. So we have reached actually below 1 nanosecond time resolution in those RPCs, which is our target. So go to slide 30. Here I am showing you the details about first, you know, in the lab work, and where we have all participated, our students, our scientific people, and everybody, and then we are making these 1 meter by 1 meter RPCs here. Then go to 31. These RPCs are then stuck together to build a cosmic horoscope, and to understand the performance of these tracking for the muon tracking. That is the main purpose of our ICAL detector. And this is a 12-mark stack. And below that you can see the analog signal. And that is, can see from the muon, it's very fast signal, but very clean and clear signal. And on the right hand side top, you can see the charge spectrum from such an RPC due to the muon, and in the bottom, the time resolution with something like 1.5 nanosecond sigma. Going to next slide, actually I want to skip that slide. 32 is where I'm showing the gas system, etc., that has been developed. Let's go to slide 33, where now I'm showing you the tracking capabilities of our RPC system. These are the various cosmic ray muons that have been tracked and continuously being monitored in our lab here in TRFR. So this has been showing the tracking capabilities, they demonstrate that the detector will do its job when it is ready. Go to slide 34. Here some of these again details about these RPCs. For example, in the top left hand corner, you can see the strip multiplicity and how many strip when a muon is going through, and on an average you can see only one strip is firing. Then in the bottom, the blue on the left hand side is the noise monitoring over time. This is quite stable. And in the bottom right hand corner, what I'm showing is the tracking, the imaging capabilities, that is the muons when they're hitting, how accurately you can measure their position. The white spots are where you have those spacers, and which is the dead space for the detector. So that's why you are not detecting any muons in those space. So that is showing the characteristics of these typical and imaging characteristics of the RPCs as a detector. Go to slide 35. Now this is actually where we have started making these 2 meter by 2 meter RPCs, but in our lab still we are making in our lab. So here in the left, top left, this 3 mm 2 meter by 2 meter, this is very fragile, you know, glass piece. So you have to put it carefully on the working table. Then you have to put a mask and put all those in between these, this what you call these spacers there, and then you remove the spacers in the right hand side on the top, you can see only, you remove this mask and then you can see the spacers on the glass very clearly. Then you glue on them, and then on top of them you put the top glass plate, and then you put the spacer that's shown in the bottom middle picture, and then finally your RPC is ready and to be used. And then you can go to the next slide, then you can use those 2 meter by 2 meter RPCs also, again go through the same cosmic ray tracking and see their capabilities and so on. And this is all also going on. However, you can imagine that 30,000 of these RPCs cannot be built by us, so you have to interact with the industry. So go to the slide 37, where I am showing that the capabilities of a local industry in Bombay. So this is actually a glass making factory, and in the top right hand corner you can see that they can handle these large glass plates using these vacuum chucks. Then in the top middle is a chamber where you can clean those glasses inside, and then they come out, and then you do the graphite coating on the surface, that is on the right side, right top hand corner. And then this some of those graphite coated glass plates are shown in the middle bottom. So this is the factory, there are possibilities of doing these RPCs. Then go to slide 38, where the factory already started making those RPCs in large number, not so large number, something like 25-30 they have made as a demonstration project. And in the bottom you can see we are bringing one of those RPCs built in that factory in our lab for testing. So now this is the demonstration capability, but you have to still go further. So if you go to the next slide, now this is actually how I am showing the tools for the RPC mass production. In the top, actually you are seeing the automatic glue and button dispensing machine that we have developed. It is a CNC based machine which will automatically put the buttons, put the glue on the RPCs. And in the bottom I am showing you this is a painting which will do the graphite coating on the glass plate. So this is all developed and we are ready to start the mass production of the RPCs. Now to slide 39 is just one transparency show that as a backup we are also working on the Bakelite RPCs in our collaborating institute in Kolkata, in Sai Institute and BECC, and there also this is a parallel project that is going on, but our baseline idea is to use the glass RPCs that we have developed by now. Go to slide 41, actually skip 41 and go to slide 42, where I am showing is a prototype magnet. Now this is we have a detector at Kolkata in BECC, where we have set up a small prototype where the magnet as well as the RPCs are put there in a sandwich fashion. And go to slide 43, and we have started seeing these bending of the tracks, muon tracks, in this magnetic field because of this. So this is also demonstrated and going on well. Now go to slide 44. We have to also, in addition to the development of the detector work, we have to think about the electronics. So what we have now in the top, you can see in this picture, is the electronics that we are currently use the front end amplifier, and they are occupying lots of large space because they are a hybrid preamplifier. However, what we want to build from there, that miniaturize those amplifiers by using ASIC. And in the bottom, now this is the artist drawn how the ASIC will look like. But if you go to slide 45, you can see in the top is the design of that ASIC. Actually it is that been designed. This is an 8 amplifier in one chip, and this is an amplifier discriminator all put into one 100 gain amplifier with a discriminator followed by that with your ADS output. And this is now being tested and it's performing quite well, and hopefully we'll be able to mass produce them soon. In the bottom is also another ASIC development of a TDC that has been developed by our colleagues from IIT Chennai. The institute is very close to the IMSC, and this has also been developed, and we are currently testing this one also in our lab. Now going to slide 45, what I'm showing how this RPC will finally look like. This will be the blue color is the RPC, and in the corner in the triangle region is where all the data acquisition hardware will be located, and this will be FPGA based. And each RPC, all the data acquisition hardware software will go into that chip, and this will be connected by actually TCP/IP to the, our backend server, and that's it. So we'll be able to, you know, address any RPCs, collect data from there, put them together, and so on. Now go to slide 46. While I'm showing you the iCal trigger system, but because of the lack of time, I will want to skip that one and go to slide 47, while I'm going to the status of the detector development right now. So what we have, the R&D is almost complete for the RPC detector development. The full-size RPCs are being fabricated not only in the INO lab, but also in the industry. The methods, the machinery, production optimization for large-scale production of RPCs are being developed with the help of industry. I have shown you some slides on that. The electronics for iCal, the design and prototyping of the electronics trigger data acquisition system progressing well. I have shown you some picture. The second batch of the ASIC front-end designed by the INO electronic team and fabricated by Europractice IC services being tested in our lab. The TDC ASIC also has been developed by the IIT Chennai. These are under test. The magnet, I have shown you the prototype magnet that we are running in VECC Kolkata, and soon we are going to full size magnet, that is the 8 meter by 8 meter by 20 layers engineering module will be built in next couple of years as a part of our, you know, preparation for the final detector. Go to slide 39. Now let me come to this INO simulation status. So go to slide 50. The simulation framework is where we have the neutrino generator we are using currently NEONS, but we can use the other generator also, and which is basically generating the neutrino event, giving us the vortex position inside the detector, the energy and momentum of all the particles. Then they are thrown into the GN4 based detector simulation package, where we have now put the whole geometry of the INO iCal, and then it will go through that, it will give you the heat positions and so on, and then even digitization, where we convert this heat position into the strip number of the RPC, and then the efficiency and noise is also put there, and that is how the event will look like. And then we have the event reconstruction, where we use Kalman filter based track reconstruction packages and do calculate the energy momentum of the muons, and then the hadrons, and then finally that of the neutrino. So this is all framework is working, and many of our students are actively using the data for simulation and physics studies. So if you go to the slide 50, the status of INO simulation, the inhomogeneous magnetic field has been implemented, the muon track reconstruction, we have good understanding of the energy and direction resolution, but improvements are still possible and going on. The hadron energy resolutions available all with us, but not used in the results that will be showing in this next few transparencies. The neutron energy resolution and reconstruction using muon and hadron momenta are in progress. And of course, we have also optimized the ion plate thickness as it has been completed. Go to slide 52, also ideas of the detector performances, the efficiencies. The top one is the reconstruction efficiency for the muon track, and the bottom one is the charge identification efficiencies. They are quite well. Go to slide 53, where I am showing the muon momentum resolution in the top one as a function of the momentum angle, that is the muon angle, and in the bottom one, the angular resolution for different direction inside the detector as a function of energy. Now from there, using this now, if you go to slide 54, here I am showing you the capabilities of the INO iCal detector for measuring the atmospheric parameters. And here I am showing you its capabilities for sine square 2 theta 2 3 and delta m square 3 2 plane, and the current result that we have from the MINOS and the SK, L by E and zenith angle is shown, and that has been shown in the neutrino 2012 is shown in this picture in black and in purple and green, and the capabilities of the INO with a 5 years data is shown in the blue, and with a 10 years of data is shown in the red. Of course, you can combine these all these results to a global fit, and you can get the better understanding of the atmospheric parameters. Now go to slide 55, where I am showing the mass hierarchy capabilities of the INO iCal detector alone, actually. And depending upon what is the value of sine square 2 theta 1 3, and we have shown you three lines for three values of sine square theta 1 3, 0.12, 0.1 and 0.08. And keeping the values of the other parameter fixed, that is sine square theta 2 3 is at maximal 0.5. So this is shown here with the INOICAL as a function of number of years of running. So this is only INOICAL. If you go to now 56, where we are combining, of course, by the time INOICAL will be running, there will be all the other, for example, the reactor experiment will be doing much precision measurement of the parameter, the NOVA and T2K will be running. So if you can combine these all these experiments and then INOICAL along with that, this is the capabilities shown in the left hand side for the normal hierarchy and right hand side again for the inverted hierarchy, and we have here marginalized with the errors that will be available in that time for these various parameters. And this is with this for the mass hierarchy capabilities, you can see quite good. Now go to slide 57, where we are comparing the mass hierarchy capabilities of the INOICAL with the other long baseline experiment, especially for the delta CP. See, for advantage for us is this atmospheric neutrino, the mass hierarchy measurement is almost CP invariant. It doesn't matter what is the value of the CP phase. We have the equal capabilities of measuring it. However, in the for the long baseline, they precisely depends upon the value of the delta CP. And of course, you can always again combine the long baseline and the other INO experiment, and the combined capabilities in red color, where you are showing this, how will be, what will be the total capabilities, global capabilities of finding out the mass hierarchy as a function of delta CP. So this is actually some of the analysis that we have completed. Several other physics analyses are now going on, and we will be able to give you more results in near future. So stay tuned for our physics analysis. Now finally, and one important aspect on 58 on slide, the human resource development. It is one of the important aspects of our INO project that we have told you in the beginning, that from 2008 itself, we have started the INO graduate program, and to create this, you know, the manpower who will have the confidence to building this detector in the years to come. And not only they will participate in this INO experiment, but hopefully when they are you know, matured enough, and they will go out and participate in other high energy physics experiment globally, where we are also participating in other places. So this is now affiliated to the Homi Bhabha National Institute. So at present, the INO students are being trained for 1 year at TIFR through classroom as well as to lab works. And then they are being attached to the PhD guides at various collaborating institutions all over the country for their PhD degree. And of course, in addition to these main the PhD students, we also have many short and long-term visits in our RPC labs. There are many people come and participate in the summer program, in this program. So this is how we are working for the development of the human resources in the country. So that I am giving you in the Lex transplant is 59, basically the time scale. We hope that with the 5 year from now, we'll be able to start the first module that is will be there in that one, on the next subsequent years, these next two modules. And with that, let me complete my talk. So thank you for your attention, and we look forward to welcome you at the INO site. Thank you.
Okay. Questions, comments? Questions for our model? No questions? I think if everybody is waiting for lunch. Some of the faces that you saw there, many of those students are here. So for people from outside, they can interact with those students and ask the, you know, discuss things with them. Okay.
And thank you, Nova. It was wonderful. Nice.